Hello, everyone, and welcome to a new episode of The Stock Room. Today we have Millie Pearson, who is the CEO at The Edit. Millie, welcome.
Hi, thank you
very
much.
How are you doing today?
Yeah, very good. Very good, thank you.
Awesome. Right, so why don't you start by telling us a little bit about yourself, The Edit, what you guys do, and how you ended up there?
Yeah, sure. So for those that don't know, The Edit London is a global marketplace for limited edition sneakers, streetwear, and collectibles. We are 3 years old, so we've just recently had our third birthday. And my journey with The Edit started about 7 months into that process. So we were gearing up for... I knew Moses, the founder, previously, and he reached out to me as we were gearing. He was gearing up to do an investment round, so he brought me on just contractually to kind of support doing the deck, doing the P&L, and kind of preparing the business for that. It's safe to say that went really well because three years later, I'm still here. So we went through that successfully, and off the back of that, he offered me a full-time job as COO at The Edit London. Previous to that, I worked at Arcadia, so I've been in retail for about 8 years now. So the business started as a online marketplace, but we now do have three luxury concessions all around the world, in Harrods, Harvey Nichols in Saudi, and Gallery Lafayette in Doha. So we're now kind of a very multi-channel business that operates globally.
Awesome. And what led you into physical retail so early? It's something that we're seeing more and more lately, and I'm just curious about that decision and how it happened.
Yeah, I mean, we had many talks at the start about saying that we were always going to kind of stick to our bread and butter and stick to the e-commerce side. But as always, things do change along the journey. We had a great opportunity kind of come to us from Harrods. They approached us, kind of saying about that we had the opportunity to be on three floors across Harrods department store in London. And obviously we were looking at that as far as you can get. It's one of the kind of highest premium luxury real estates that you can get, which aligns really nicely with our brand, because kind of that's where we're pitching ourselves in the market, at that kind of high-end luxury. So it just felt like it was a good fit. Fast forward, you know, we launched there in just a matter of months. The full process only took a couple of months and was hugely successful from day one. So driving more revenue than we ever believed could come from that area. So that's where we obviously then were looking at what other opportunities there were. So I'm not going to say never, but we have no... insight to kind of open our own retail store. So we're just looking at the concession model, which works really well for us at the moment. And we do some pop-ups as well, but nothing permanent on the high street just yet.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I think lately, even with our previous interview with Koyo, that's something that came up. A lot of the brands that have been born in the last few years are going omnichannel since day one. And I find that really interesting in comparison to some of the brands that Neblov used to work with when we started in 2012. A lot of them were pure play online direct to consumer brands. So I find that shift kind of interesting. In your case specifically, yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say, like, I think, you know, you've got to look at what your consumers want, and a lot of consumers are just turning to online shopping now. That's definitely a trend that we've seen. But there still are consumers out there that want that kind of experience and go in store. And actually, they might go in store to feel, touch the product, and then still go home and order it online. So it means that you're kind of being able to talk to all of your customers and not kind of alienating any, I suppose. It also, physical space gives you the opportunity to, like, build the brand more, and like kind of the community feel, because again, your customers can go into store and meet your staff and kind of get a feel of what the brand is. So it's kind of different touch points, which I do think is really important.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And one more aspect that I think stands out when it comes to The Edit, or at least for me, when I was originally researching the brand, is obviously, with physical retail, there is a very direct, tangible, almost relationship between the customer and the product. But with online marketplaces, it is a bit different. And I think what's interesting is a lot of marketplaces just stick to the basics, which is connecting the two sides of the transactions, of the transaction, sorry, and that's pretty much it. But when it comes to the edit, you've actually managed to deliver a lot of incremental value on top of that, where you're facilitating the relationship between the customer and the end product they're buying. So can you speak a bit more to that?
Yeah, I think that's really important. It's really important for brands to know who their customer is. And obviously you get a lot of data from online, which is great, but it's like about building that physical picture out. So, you know, almost personifying your customer as much as possible. There's loads of ways that we've done that. I mean, we host events where we invite a lot of our customers that have shopped as well to come like to the things that we're doing. We reach out to them frequently for surveys. We communicate through our social channels with them. And it's about understanding how they like to shop and what their needs are. And as soon as you know that, then you can start to build your brand around that. And it forms this really nice community. And that's something I think Edit London's done really well. Like, we don't really, yes, we've got our customers, but actually they're part of our community, and they're not just coming onto the website to transact and buy a sneaker. They're coming on to see what's cool, what pe like who's been spotted wearing that, how to style it. We have our personal shopping team, which is in-house, which is a huge part of our business as well. And they'll all, you know, they're communicating with their customers every single day via WhatsApp or whichever medium that those customers want to communicate with. So I guess, yeah, loads of things that kind of brings me on, like the communication as well as like how you communicate with customers. I think a lot of brands, like historically, you know, it's emails and you go and it's all quite formal and everything. But again, like the consumer these days is very different. They like to either WhatsApp or go onto the DMs and chat to you there, or it might be a phone call. So it's being able to adapt and communicate with the consumers how they like, and you get a lot more from that. So we kind of work along every single medium of communication, from WhatsApp, texts, emails, social, chat on the website, etc.
Yeah, that's crucial. Trying to go beyond just a transactional relationship and try to build a brand identity that can actually stand on its own. I think especially for marketplaces is something that can really make you stand out. And then in your space, I know that authentication of the product is also a big concern. And it's something that a lot of marketplaces have tried to solve in different ways with different levels of automation and human work. So how do you approach authentication at the edit?
Okay, perfect. Love this question. It's something that we're hugely passionate about. It, essentially, it is the heart of our business, and you know, super important. Every single product that we ever sell comes through our HQ. That's, you know, if it's coming in from one of our sellers and out to the consumer, or if it's coming in and then getting shipped out to our concessions across the world. So it's all coming through this hub. We've got, I believe we've got the best authentication team in the UK. I'm pretty confident about that. And it's a team of five or six on any day, can grow depending on kind of time of the year. And it kind of goes, the shoe will go through many processes before it gets to that point of where we give it that kind of tick and seal of approval. What goes into that is, you know, feeling it, the smell of it. People laugh when I say the smell, but the smell of the shoe is really important. Just for an example, I suppose unregulated factories, when they're producing the fakes, don't have, you know, all of the parameters and provisions you have to have around what glues you can use for toxicity. So they'll tend to use a more toxic glue. So that means when you open the shoe box and you can get a really strong smell, normally
I
that's
see.
like one of the giveaways that maybe something's not right here. Other giveaways is obviously Nike is mass produced shoes. So like the Dunk Panda, which I'm sure most people have got or have seen before, that is a mass produced shoe, and Nike is churning out hundreds and hundreds of pairs. There's a lot of imperfections. So, you know, misstitching, bit of glue mark. It's really, really common on those shoes. So when you get a Dunk Panda, and you get it out of the box and it's immaculate and it's perfect, that is also a sign potentially that that's a not a real shoe, which again is kind of everything goes against everything that we think. Yeah, so the guys, it's all about that. There's the UV lights. The product goes through a UV light. We put it in a light box as well and take images of the whole shoe. So it's very robust. We have and are looking at introducing some AI technology in as well, but we will never get rid of that human element because I think there's just so many things that, as great as AI is in certain things, there's other things that it just can't replace. So that would just be giving like that additional layer. So when we do have a fake that comes in, it will kind of go through the AI as well to kind of give that like seal mark of approval. Yeah, that we definitely got a fake on our hands.
Yeah, that's really interesting because I was expecting it to be a very mathematical, logical approach. And it's interesting to know that it's a very nuanced thing. Definitely didn't expect the smell to be such an important element. So that's
and each shoe has its own smell, apparently. I mean, I'm not expert at authentication, but I do hear what the guys say. And they know that the Sacai Vapor Waffle has like this certain sweet smell. And then they know that the Dunks have another certain smell. So if there's a variation there, it's like an alarm bell.
Interesting. And then is a segue into fulfillment and logistics. One more trend that we've been seeing lately that I think we also discussed in our pre-interview is more brands starting to do their logistics in-house so they can have more end-to-end control over the transaction and how it's perceived from the customer and what that experience feels like. And I know that that's something that you strongly believe in, being able to own your distribution and the customer experience around receiving a product. And that's part of the value that you're creating. So how are you approaching that part? What do you think are some of the advantages that this has created for you?
I mean, it allows the business to maintain complete control. And especially when there's businesses, particular businesses have kind of core values. So sustainability is a pretty core value for us here at The Edit. And it, you know, us owning that process means that we can manage that from start to finish. And, you know, there's a lot of people that kind of say they're doing certain things and, you know, not quite there. So we've kind of, it's given us the ability to implement quite a lot of change how we think that will resonate with our customers and that our customers will care about. So a couple of those is, you know, we've completely revamped our whole packaging. So we have fully recycled and recyclable boxes that go out now with our branding, and it's all multi-use boxes and things like that. We actually have invested in a machine as well, which turns all of our inbound cardboard. We've called it Chewy. It's got a name. And we feed all of, because we obviously, all of our sneakers, when they get sent to us from the sellers, will come in cardboard boxes that we can't reuse because it will have branding on or whatever. So we put that through the machine and it takes that in, turns that into like a corrugated replacement for bubble wrap, if you know. So we've got rid of bubble wrap completely. And now what we're doing is we're actually repurposing about 80 to 90% of all of our inbound cardboard, which is, you know, fantastic. And one, it lowers costs of having to refuge or getting rid of it. And then B, it means that we're kind of repurposing everything. We've like hand cherry picked kind of our delivery services that we use. So we use DHL for global because they do Go Green, which is a full kind of green process for shipment. We use electric vans for our same day service, which we've rolled out for London areas, and we're actually soon to roll it out in Birmingham and Manchester as well. So that kind of end mile is all green. So yeah, multiple things, but again, we're just constantly tweaking and making little changes here and there, until we get that kind of sweet spot.
Yeah, that makes sense. And how has that impacted the business in terms of KPIs? Because I think when it comes to sustainability, the usual conversation that I hear is that something you do for the environment and because you care, it's not necessarily good for the brand beyond just being an advertising move. So what can you tell us about that? How have you seen customers respond? How has it actually moved the needle?
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, look, unfortunately, being sustainable and doing the right thing is not always the cheapest way to do something. So that just needs to be a conversation that you look at and look at, you know, can we afford to lose a couple of percentages in our profit? But actually, what are the gains from doing that? And it's all about that A/B testing in that environment, in that scenario. So, you know, we've launched something where we actually, for every sale on our e-commerce platform, we donate money. Ourselves, so it's not coming from the customer, it's from the edit, which takes plastic out of the oceans, and that's a partnership with a company called Handprint. So that we've got like a ticker at the top of our website, so you can kind of see. I think we went past our 500,000 plastic bottles out of the ocean quite recently, which was a really nice milestone for us. And so when we first launched that, we did the A/B testing. 50% of our consumers saw that that was what we were doing, and we were donating. 50% didn't, and the difference in the conversion was astronomical versus, you know, the people that could see. So that just proves that, again, at the moment, and I think it's a trend that's going to continue for the foreseeable future, consumers are buying with a conscience, and they are, you know, wanting to be made to feel nice when they purchase, rather than going to fast fashion brands, or, you know, your money just being going towards something that you're going to wear a couple of times. It's that investment piece. So yeah, I think that example kind of just proves if you're doing the right thing, actually it can generate more revenue in the long run that wouldn't have been there otherwise.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And then there's a whole other side to your business, right? Because you have your online marketplace, you have wholesale partnerships, and then you have resellers.
Yes, exactly.
So how does that relationship work? And what do you do to maintain a level of brand consistency and experience consistency in that case?
Yeah, okay, great question. So, yeah, you're right. We see ourselves as two customers. So we've got the consumer that's purchasing on the website, and then we've got our resellers, our consignors, and we see them, you know, vital obviously to the business. And what we've done is we spent kind of a solid year and a half perfecting the back end technology, which we've built. It's our own proprietary tech that we've built from scratch. We've built that out so that we are enabling those resellers who typically they're like aged 18 to 23 years old, live at home with their parents, you know, just want to flip some sneakers and earn 20 quid here and there. They're not businessmen, so we've built the platform to enable them to become, you know, really successful small business units on their own. And that in turn then means that they're going to go and buy more stock. They're going to put it on our marketplace. We're going to have more product available. It's going to drive the price down because of competitivity. And then that will then result in our end consumer being more happy because we've got the better product. We've got it, you know, at a cheaper price, et cetera. So I think that process is really important. And I guess where we pitch ourselves in the market, as I mentioned, is that very high luxury brand. And consumers on the front end are getting that because they're having a beautiful website, which is really easy to use. There's no, you know, you've not got to figure out if this is going to be authentic product or if the seller's legitimate, what rate star rating has the seller got on eBay. Like, do we trust them? You don't have to do any of that. We do all that for you in the back end. So it's kind of like a swan, I suppose, as an analogy. The top is all calm, and then the back end, the marketplace side, which the consumers can't see, that's where everything's going. You know, cogs are turning pretty quickly, and essentially we're doing all that hard work, so both side of our customers don't have to.
I think that's actually pretty magical. We were chatting a bit in the pre-interview about the fact that I once had to buy a pair of sneakers for my sister's birthday on StockX, and it was the most stressful buying experience I've ever had. And I think therein lies the power of a great marketplace, like taking all of that stress and making it disappear. Because they're taking on that responsibility, and that's something that I, as a consumer, am more than happy to pay for.
Yeah, that's actually like bringing that up. That's actually how the idea from the Edit London was born. So just going back a little bit to the start, was the founder was at a sneaker festival, and he was about to buy a pair of sneakers for around £700, quite expensive in the market for a pair of sneakers. You'll probably agree. And as he was going to pay, he asked for a plastic bag to put the shoes in, and the person that he was buying them off didn't have one. So he ends up, you know, 30-something-year-old man walking around a sneaker festival with a load of kids, sneakers under his arm, had to pay cash because they didn't take Amex or anything like that. So it was, it just kind of blew his mind that there was like, you're paying for a premium product, but there is no premium service. It's, you know, it's kind of that, that's it. And people just accepted that that's how the sneaker market was. And now I guess what we're doing is we're kind of changing people's minds and saying it doesn't have to be like that. You can have a really good experience. You can feel really great when you buy your sneakers. You don't have to feel a little bit grubby or worried that they're not going to turn up.
Yeah.
And that's what we've kind of built the platform around in the business.
Well, I think that's amazing. And what else can we expect from The Edit this year? I saw that you recently launched a pre-loved marketplace, right?
Yeah. So that we've done in, we've recently launched that, and that's kind of in phase one. And there's a whole other phase of that, which is coming, which is really exciting. So we're going to be doing, our personal shopping team have obviously got on their books, like loads of kind of celebrities, footballers, musicians, really cool people. So we're going to launch a capsule collections where we actually go to these people's houses, raid their wardrobes for things to sell, and then it's available to buy on the Edit London site. So that's going to be really fun. And then we're kind of doing a few different things in that space with pre-love to kind of build that out. We're also about to launch any day a subscription model, which obviously anyone then can be part of. So again, it's kind of opening up that community feel, but there's different tiers of subscriptions that all come with kind of points that you can earn, discounts, refer a friend vouchers, all those kind of things, which is quite exciting. What else? We've got lots, a couple more stores due to open this year in luxury concessions around the world. We've got loads of events, cool events, pop-ups. We're actually doing we're presenting partner for a really cool sneaker festival, which I can't name just yet, but later on in the year. Where we're going to have like shootout basketball competitions and things like that, which will be really fun. Plenty planned. It's not going to be a quiet year, that's for sure.
Awesome. Yeah, that's a lot of stuff. Pretty full roadmap. Tell me a bit about the subscription program. How is that going to work, if you can share anything?
Yeah, so all of our customers that have shopped ever, we've basically collated all of their shopping history, and from that means that they, once the subscription launches, as long as they create an account, they'll be able to already see like what points they've earned. So it means that you're not having to start from zero, or any new customers coming on, all you need to do is just create an account on the Edit London, which you do when you purchase anyway. And from there, you can start earning points. So for every pound you spend, you're earning points. You can get to certain, when you get to certain levels, it will trigger a free gift, like sneaker cleaning and things like that. Birthday vouchers, all sorts. So it's kind of like, as you spend, we then reward you throughout. It's quite exciting. It's going to be called the Locker Room, and there'll be tiers that you can kind of move through.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's one more way that you can move like beyond transactional and become more of a one-stop shop for that area of your customers' lives. So I think it's pretty exciting.
I think that's it's a really nice feature when you go onto certain websites and they have that kind of loyalty subscription program, because it makes you feel like part of the club. And again, and when you're thinking about buying your next purchase, you're like, oh, actually, I've got like £20 of vouchers over there from a few weeks ago. Let me just jump in and use that. And you'll get direct contact with our personal shopping team as well. So it's kind of that extra level of service attached to it if you've got an account with us.
Yeah, it's all about brand identity. All right. I think that's it. Millie, thanks so much for taking the time to chat with us. I'm really looking forward to seeing what The Edit does this year. Huge fan. I'm not a huge sneaker fan, but I'm a huge The Edit fan, so I might become a sneaker fan.
Do you know what? When I started working, I didn't know the difference between an Air Force and a Jordan, and I just about... So I wasn't a sneaker fan.
Yeah.
This time you can be converted.
Yeah, come to the dark side. All right. Thank you so much, Millie.
Awesome. Thank you.
Have a good day.
Bye.